많이 낙관론이 만연할 때는 좀 이익도 챙겨두시고 주가 많이 빠졌을 때는 좀 사보는 거예요. 평범한 사람들이 장기적으로 주식시장에 살아남을 수 있는 방법이지 같이 흥분하고 같이 두려워하는 상황에서는 시장이 만만치 않을 것이다.
조금 차분하게 대응하는 것이 좋지 않을까. 최근의 장세에 편승해서 조금 가짜 성장주 이런 부분들이 굉장히 많이 숨어 있거든요. 네네. 제가 볼 때는 이런 부분에 대한 옥석 가리기가 올해는 굉장히 클 거기 때문에
투자라는 걸 한마디로 정의하면 저는 이렇게 정의합니다. 네. 세상과 나의 건강한 긴장관계를 유지하는 행위가 투자다.
이제 막 주식시장에 뛰어든 분들이 나에 대해 성찰하고 시장을 보는 눈을 기르길 원하는 김한진, 윤지호, 김동완의 투자 원칙과 인사이트를 공유합니다. 주식의 시대, 투자의 자세에서 확인하세요. 전국 서점과 온라인에서 만나보실 수 있습니다.
산업을 이해하고 기업을 이해해야 돈의 흐름이 보입니다. 리서치명가 메리츠증권과 3프로TV가 함께 야심차게 준비한 3프로TV 주식대학 겨울학기 실전투자 특강. 남보다 한 발 앞서서 유망한 산업을 판단하고 1등 종목을 선정하는 투자의 기본기를 다지는 시간이 될 겁니다. 국내 최고의 애널리스트 21명과 함께 떠나는 2021년 성공투자를 위한 단 하나의 필수 코스. 지금 바로 신청하세요. 자세한 사항은 페이지 2 공지사항을 확인하세요. 네, 여러분 또 오래 기다리셨습니다. 글로벌 머니톡스 오랜만에 또 이어가겠습니다. 오늘 저희가 인터뷰할 분은요. 자, 인터뷰는 아마 이런 고민으로 시작한 게 아닐까 싶습니다. 요즘 우리나라의 주식시장 참가자들 중에는 물론 이제 개인 투자자들이 꽤 힘을 발휘하고 있긴 합니다만 여전히 큰 변수는 외국인 투자자들 아니겠습니까? 그런데 우리들 항상 외국인 투자자들이 우리 이 시장에 대해서 어떻게 생각하는지는 늘 짐작만 하거나 추측을 하거나 늘 그런 식의 차단된 정보만을 주로 우리가 접해왔습니다. 그래서 오늘 외국인 투자자들 중에서도 한국 시장, 아시아 시장을 특별히 포커스해서 리서치하는 분들이 있으실 것 같아서 그 중에 크레딧 스위스의 아시아 투자 전략 부문 공동대표인 댄 파인먼을 저희가 화상으로 줌을 통해서 인터뷰해보겠습니다. 인터뷰 도와주실 중앙일보 강남규 팀장님 오늘도 나오셨습니다. 어서 오세요.
안녕하세요. 네. 저 강남규입니다.
이 솔직히 말씀드리면 저희는 이 3프로TV는 여러분들이 다행히 많이 모여 계신 채널이라서 저희가 방송을 제작하긴 합니다만 일의 대부분은 여기 강남규 기자께서 직접 섭외도 하시고 통화도 하시고 그러고 있습니다. 저는 옆에서 그냥 정말 숟가락만 얹고 도와드리는 입장이기도 하고요. 그래서 늘 감사드립니다. 오늘 저희가 인터뷰할 댄 파인먼 씨는 어떤 분입니까? 조금 더 소개를 좀 해주시죠.
예일 대학에서 지역 정치 특히 동남아시아의 군부 정권과 미국과의 관계 이걸 지금 현재 태국에 주로 이제 방콕에 머물고 있으면서 아시아 시장을 담당을 하고 있는데 한국 시장에 대해서 아마 가장 그 적극적으로 코멘트를 하는 그 투자 전략가입니다.
외국인 투자자들은 가장 한국 시장에 대해서는 참고하고 있는.
아 그렇죠. 굉장히
노란 머리 파란 눈의 전문가.
그렇죠. 그들의 시각이 그들의 눈에 비치는 한국 증시의 모습을 알아볼 수 있는 기회라고 할까요?
네,
그렇습니다.
자 오늘 그러면 바로 연결해서 궁금한 질문을 좀 하도록 하죠. 크레딧 스위스 아시아 투자 전략 부문 댄 파인먼 공동 대표를 연결해 보겠습니다. 안녕하십니까?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, lovely, very lovely.
Okay, great.
최근에 그 다른 매체와 인터뷰에서 기업 이익의 슈퍼 사이클이라는 말을 하셨더라고요. 제가 알기로는 슈퍼 사이클은 장기적인 호황 내지는 장기적인 자산 가격의 상승 아니면 원유가의 상승 이런 데 주로 쓰이는 단어로 알고 있는데 그렇다면 2021년 올해 이후에 한국 등의 기업 이익 증가가 오랫동안 지속될 것이라고 보는 것으로 이해해도 될까요?
Well, 2021 is a special year. 2021 is a bounce back year. The base number from 2020 is very low, and that means naturally you're going to have a strong growth number year on year in 2021. What I'm talking about with an earnings super cycle is beyond 2021. I'm talking about for 5 to 10 years. If you look historically, we have seen earnings cycles in the region run for 10 years or even longer, where you'll have a 10 to 15 year period of very strong growth, followed by a 10 to 15 year period of very weak growth. We're coming off a 10-year period of very weak growth. I think we're entering another period that could last 10 years or longer with very strong growth. And that's excluding 2021, which is just a statistical anomaly because we're coming off a very low base in 2020.
여전히 많은 투자자들은 코스피 지수에 버블이 꽤 있다. 그동안 사상 최고치를 계속 경신하고 있으니까요. 그런 의견도 내놓고 있습니다만 파인만 씨는 2021년을 꽤 괜찮은 시장이 될 것으로 본다면 현재 코스피 지수도 별 버블이 아니라고 판단하시겠군요.
I don't think it is. We've got extremely strong earnings growth in the Korean market, in part because we're coming off a low base from 2019. 2019 was already a low base because of weakness in the DRAM and memory cycle and weaknesses in other parts of the economy. We are coming off that low base with very strong earnings growth on a two-year view. If you look at compound annual growth in Korean earnings from 2019 to 21, it's the best in Asia. And a lot of that is the base effect. If you look at valuations, they're not stretched by relative standards. Now, at the moment, if you look at a standard PE for really almost any market on the planet, it would look expensive. But if you look at other metrics that compare stocks against alternative investments, say fixed income, stocks look cheap. Stock yields, dividend yields look cheap relative to bond yields in most markets, including in Korea. And if you look at Korean stocks relative to other stocks in the region, in Asia, or other stocks globally, they also look cheap. And so I don't think that there's at all a bubble here. We're in an unusual situation for sure. But in unusual situations, it's not unusual to have very high multiples. If you go back to 2010, you'll see that actually coming out of the global financial crisis, Asian stocks, Korean stocks included, had multiples very similar to what they have right now, actually higher than what they have right now. It's typical to have very high multiples coming out of a crisis. Those multiples will normalize over time through more rapid earnings growth, through rapid dividend growth. But at this moment, I don't think that Korea is expensive and we certainly aren't in a bubble yet.
사실 최근에 저희 장모가 가지고 있는 주식을 팔아치웠습니다.
장모님이 주식 투자하세요?
우연찮게 갖게 된 주식이 하나 있어요. 종목이 하나 있어서.
예.
알았는데 사실 좀 내심 걱정했던 게 기준금리, 그러니까 정책금리를 그 중앙은행이 인위적으로 조절한 정책금리하고 상관없이 시장금리가 올라갈 경우에 증시 주가가 하락할 수 있는 조정받을 수 있는 그런 리스크가 가장 그 걱정이 되더라고요. 어떻습니까, 이 부분은?
Yeah, it depends on what interest rate you're talking about. We expect that the yield curve will steepen next year. It's already steepened a bit since we had the US elections and the announcements on vaccines from Pfizer and Moderna. There's room for the yield curve to steepen further, but it would steepen via higher long-term rates, not higher short-term rates. I think that that's generally a healthy formula at this point in time. If you consider what impact interest rates have on bank lending in Asia, it's mainly priced, banks mainly price their loans off the short end of the curve, off short-term rates. So if short-term rates stay low, then bank loans will stay low. Now, Korea is a bit of a difference. There are mortgages priced in Korea off the long end of the curve, but in other parts of Asia, generally banks price off the short end of the curve. If you have the long end of the curve rising, if long-term interest rates are rising, that's because the economy is doing well and because investors are turning optimistic about growth prospects. So a steep yield curve for most of Asia is actually a very good thing because it means that you retain those low short-term rates and low bank lending rates, but the higher long-term rates are a reflection of better growth, which clearly is good for equity. So we're not concerned at this point in time, especially given how low short-term, both short-term and long-term rates are at the moment. Now, at some point, higher long-term rates will be a negative for equities because it will make bonds more attractive relative to equities. If long-term bond yields go up, then people will potentially be more likely to take their money out of stocks and put them into bonds. But at the current levels where we're talking about, say, long-term interest rates going from maybe 0.9% to 1.3%, these are still really very low rates by historical standards. And that's a really bad return for a 10-year bond. And there's a lot of risk still attached to buying a 10-year bond that's trading at 1.3, 1.5%. If that goes up to 3%, you lose a lot of money. So I think that with a moderate rise in long-term rates, equities can do very well in Asia. Beyond a certain point, no, but we're nowhere near that point yet.
예, 알겠습니다. 근데 요즘 계속 꾸준히 최근에 외국인들이 한국 증시, 한국 주식, 한국 자산을 좀 많이 사들이고 있습니다. 어떻습니까? 외국인들의 투자가 뭐 꾸준히 이어질까요?
I do. Foreign weightings aren't high right now. We've seen a lot of inflows, but we need to recall that foreigners were largely selling 2018, 19, and in the first three quarters of this year. 2018, you might recall, we had foreigners piling into U.S. stocks because of tax cuts. 2019, you had the trade war, which scared a lot of foreigners away from Asia. Then the pandemic led to a flight into U.S. Securities. So there's still plenty of room for foreigners to buy. And if the story is good, if the fundamentals for Asia are good, foreigners will go overweight. If they're underweight now, they could buy just to go to neutral, but I think they probably will be going into overweight given the advantages of Asian stocks relative to US stocks.
한국과 일본 관계 특수한 관계에 비춰 봤을 때 이 최근에 말씀하신 일본 주식은 피하라고 투자자들에게 권했는데 그건 흥미롭게 들렸습니다. 왜 그런 투자 권고를 했는지 그 배경을 좀 설명해 주실 수 있을까요?
Let me first clarify the position of Credit Suisse as a house. We have recommendations on a global basis and on an Asia Pacific basis. Globally, we have a neutral weighting in Japan if you're buying local currency. We have a small overweight globally if you're running a dollar-based portfolio, because we expect currency gains from the yen against the dollar. So that would be mainly Japan versus, say, the US and Europe. Then we also have recommendations for investors who only invest in the Asia Pacific region. And there we have a different recommendation because the benchmark is different. Within Asia Pacific, we're underweight Japan. And that's because we see better prospects for Asia, excluding Japan, for the other countries in Asia, like China, Korea, Taiwan, India, Southeast Asia. So why do we prefer the rest of Asia to Japan? Currencies are a key factor. When the dollar is weak, Asia outside of Japan tends to outperform on a global basis and also tends to outperform Japan. When the dollar is strong, then Japan tends to do better than Asia, excluding Japan. Why is that? Well, it works on both directions. Japan exports a lot into the US, and when the dollar is strong, it means that its exports relative to American manufacturers are very cheap, and so it can export more to the US. For Asia, it's more about dollar weakness being positive for two reasons. Number one, when the dollar is weak, it means that foreigners, Americans, are exporting, tend to export a lot of equity portfolio capital to invest in Asian and other emerging markets. Also, when the dollar is weak, global trade tends to do well, and Asia outside of Japan is an extremely trade-dependent economy. So that dollar view is important. We are dollar bears. We think that we could be entering a multi-year dollar bear cycle. And if you are bearish on the dollar, you want to be overweight in Asia, excluding Japan. You want to be underweight Japan. Another factor is cyclical. When the global economy is in a recovery mode and global growth is accelerating, generally, the rest of Asia outperforms Japan. Why is this? It's because the rest of Asia tends to be more export-oriented and it has more cyclical exposure than Japan does. So it's mainly these two factors that lead us to overweight the rest of Asia vis-a-vis Japan. On the valuation front, it's sort of balanced. I'd say that Asia ex Japan is a little bit cheaper, but not much. It's more of these cyclical and currency factors that determine our view.
일본 주식을 절대적으로 버려야 될 주식이 아니고 상대적으로 한국 등 다른 나라 아시아 다른 나라의 주식이 매력적이기 때문에 상대적인 의미에서 일본 주식을 피하라 그 말씀으로 좀 이해,
그런 일본 주식을 맞죠? 담으면 그만큼 더 좋은 주식 못 담으니까
그렇죠.
그런 얘기인 것 같은데 그렇습니까?
Correct, correct. But more attractive than U.S. stocks.
Oh, of course. Okay.
Which is mainly on valuations, and also because of the cycle. The U.S. tends to be best when global growth is weak.
댄 파인먼 씨께서 전망하신 보고서들 대강 읽어봤습니다. 흥미로운 부분은 홍콩 주식 시장에 대해서도 꽤 긍정적으로 보고 계시는데 우리가 알고 있는 홍콩은 지금 상황은 정치적으로나 여러 가지 불안함이 남아있는 곳이라서 어떻게 그런 전망을 하는지 궁금한데요. 정치적 리스크가 꽤 있음에도 불구하고 2021년 올해 홍콩이 괜찮을 거라고 보시는 이유는 어떤 것입니까?
Yeah, I think Hong Kong looks interesting right now. It's quite cheap. It is highly cyclical, does quite well when global growth is improving. The current environment is actually quite ideal for Hong Kong. It has a lot of dependence. The stock market has a lot of exposure to real estate. Short-term rates, bank lending rates, mortgage rates are going to stay very low for a very long time. There's a lot of excess liquidity globally and in Hong Kong. That helps real estate as well. So you've got an ideal combination of improving growth with low interest rates, lots of excess liquidity. I think that Hong Kong property, the physical property, will do very well. That will help the property stocks and also the banking stocks. As far as the politics are concerned, you know, it's the situation has been much more stable over the past 6 to 9 months. I think that Hong Kong remains attractive, both for foreign investors who still want a foothold into mainland China, and also for mainland Chinese companies who are using Hong Kong as a window to the outside world. So Hong Kong looks very appealing to me, still as a good long-term structural place to invest, but also I'd say more importantly are the valuations and the positioning in the cycle.
미국에서 정권 교체가 이루어져서 조 바이든이 대통령에 취임했습니다. 사실 그 이 도널드 트럼프 시절에 미중 관계는 최악이었습니다. 미국 두 나라 역사에 비춰봤을 때. 그렇다라면은 홍콩 주식시장과 홍콩의 자산 가치 등 정치적인 그 리스크 생각할 때 정치적인 미중 관계 정치 리스크를 좀 고려해야 될 것 같은데 어떨까요? 그 변수는?
I think a Biden presidency will be positive for both China and Hong Kong. I don't think that we'll see a major easing of tensions between China and the U.S. under a President Biden, but he's not going to be focusing on using tariffs as a weapon. And I think he'll be taking a more multilateral approach. He'll try to present a united front to China of the US and its allies. He'll be working with Japan, with Korea, with Australia, with Europe to come up with a common policy towards China. And that means that US policy making will be more transparent, will be slower moving, will be more predictable. And it's unlikely to involve new tariffs. I don't think that Biden can get rid of the existing tariffs. That would be politically difficult. But I see very low risk that he will impose new tariffs. And if the issues between China and the US are played out through non-economic channels, then that means that there isn't so much concern for stock market investors. If the US has a diplomatic communication criticizing China for one thing or another, and China responds with its own criticism of the US, I think markets can handle that. What is difficult for markets to handle are these tariffs. And I think that we don't have to worry about those.
바이든이 트럼프가 부과한 관세를 낮출 가능성이 있을까요? 지금 현재 사실 그 두 나라 사이에는 티포텟 전략으로 관세를 주고 이거 고율의 관세를 주고 받고 있는데 매기고 있는데 어떻습니까? 그 관세를 낮출 가능성이 낮춘다라면은 상당히 세계 경제에 도움이 될 것 같은데.
I think that's a bit unlikely. I think that in his heart, Biden is not in favor of tariffs. I'm pretty confident that had he been president the past 4 years, he would not have imposed these tariffs. If you look at his history, he does generally have a history as a free trader. He was involved with the negotiations over the TPP and was officially supportive of the TPP treaty. But I think it's going to be politically difficult for him to remove Trump's tariffs without getting something substantial in return from China. And I think China will find it hard to satisfy the U.S. as far as the sort of structural measures the U.S. is demanding. U.S. wants less support for SOEs, an end to industrial policy supporting strategic industries. These are development strategies that have been extremely successful for China for the past 40 years. And China is not going to abandon those as long as they work as well as they have been. So I'm not optimistic about prospects for removing those tariffs, but it would be a big improvement just to have improved transparency and predictability. It wasn't just the tariffs that hurt Asia, it was the uncertainty factor. Because businesses, particularly exporters, didn't know what direction tariffs were going, how high they could go, everyone just froze their investment plans because of the uncertainty. And it caused disruption for supply chains because people in the supply chain didn't want to be holding excess inventories. So all of this led to problems deriving from the uncertainty. And just having certainty surrounding the existing tariffs, knowing that they're highly unlikely to go up further, that would actually be a win for Asia.
중국에 대한 질문을 하나 좀 제가 더 드려보겠습니다. 뭐 얼마 된 이야기긴 합니다만 중국에서 공기업이 디폴트 선언을 한 경우들도 꽤 있었고 중국의 부채 문제는 오랫동안 중국의 경제 리스크 중에 첫 손을 꼽혔던 그런 이슈인데 어떻게 봐야 되겠습니까? 중국 경제 리스크 혹은 중국 시장의 리스크가 어떤 게 있을지 그게 또 꽤 큰 나라이기 때문에 여러 증시에 미치는 영향도 높을 것 같아서요.
I think we need to distinguish between credit and equity investors. I think the risks potentially for debt investors, for credit investors, could be significant if you have been assuming that that all Chinese SOEs have sovereign risk, then you maybe need to reassess your positions. But for equities investors, I don't think it's a major concern. We know that the government wants markets to start pricing risk more rationally and more based on the prospects of individual companies, including SOEs. Up until now, SOE credit has been priced as sovereign. The government would like to move away from that to price in greater risk relevant to particular SOEs. And actually, when you see the government allow individual SOE bond defaults, in a way, it's a sign of confidence on the part of the government that it can allow individual SOEs to default without creating a systemic problem in credit markets. And in the long term, this would be a structural positive if markets were able to price the credit of SOEs based on the prospects of individual companies as opposed to perceived backing from the government. So for me, as an equities guy, this isn't a negative, and potentially it could be a long-term positive if they make progress in this direction.
이런 정부의 규제가 중국 정부뿐만 아니라 이런 정부의 규제가 전 세계적인 현상이라는 얘기죠.
Yes, I mean, what we're seeing right now in China, as far as particularly the competition issue, same issues are being studied and scrutinized and discussed in the U.S. and Europe now. These are global issues.
미국의 FRB에서, Fed에서 일한 적이 있더라고, 경제분석가로서요. 어떨까요? 제닌 옐런은 뛰어난 경제학자이면서 페드 의장을 지냈고 이제 새로운 정부의 재무장관입니다. 앞으로 그녀가 재무장관으로서 통화정책 등에 대한 어떤 영향을 줄 것 같습니까? 특히 그 페드의 독립성이 침해될 수 있다라는 그런 우려가 없지 않아 있는데.
I wouldn't go so far as to say that she will have a direct impact on monetary policy. The Fed is a very strong institution, very proud of its independence, and it's not going to be taking marching orders from anyone outside of the Fed, even a former Fed chairman. We are in a world where Treasury departments or finance ministries anywhere on the planet are going to be working more than before with central banks because we're now in a world of monetization of fiscal deficits, where governments run massive deficits and central banks buy up the debt to prevent interest rates from going up. And even if they aren't getting in a room together and explicitly making their plans together, I think implicitly there's a lot of cooperation between finance ministries and central banks, or in the US, you would say the Treasury Department and the Fed. Having a former Fed chairman as Treasury Secretary makes that job a bit easier.
조금 전에 흥미로운 말을 하셨는데, 일을 더 쉽게 만든다는 의미는 무슨 의미인가요? 그러니까 제닌 옐런, 옐런 재무장관이 경제정책을 결정하는데 일종의 우위를 점한다 그럴까요? 아니면 주도권을 행사한다 그럴까요? 그런 말로 이해해도 될까요?
No, I think it would maybe... any sort of cooperation with a finance ministry for any independent central bank is going to be emotionally and institutionally difficult, because the accepted wisdom for decades has been that central banks need to be independent. If central banks ever cooperate with a finance ministry or Treasury Department, it's going to lead to inflation, and investors and the public will lose faith in the central bank. Inflation expectations go up, and it all ends in tears with high inflation. And central banks are very protective of their independence. They don't consider themselves a part of the government. They consider themselves an independent entity. So it's quite difficult from an institutional perspective for a central bank like the Fed to work with a finance ministry or Treasury Department. This is an emotional, mental barrier that Jerome Powell is going to have to overcome. It will be, I think, a bit easier for him to deal with that, knowing that he's dealing with someone who sympathizes with the Fed's position and the Fed's desire to maintain its independence, even while it cooperates with the Treasury.
아주 흥미로운 설명인 것 같습니다. 그 댄 파인먼 대표가 그 페드하고 재무부에서 동시에 일한 경력이 있거든요. 두 기관의 내부의 분위기를 알게 해주는 말이어서 정말 흥미롭게 들었습니다. 감사합니다.
Yeah, well, the Fed has a very strong internal culture, very strong organizational culture, and that's what needs to be overcome a bit to facilitate cooperation with the Treasury Department.
예, 거의 뭐 마지막 질문이 될 것 같은데요. 어떻게 봐야 되겠습니까? 2021년 한국 경제에서 만약 댄 파인먼의 분석은 꽤 괜찮은 증시가 있을 거다라는 예상입니다만, 혹시 그 예상과 충돌하게 될 어떤 변수나 뭐 리스크나 이런 게 있다면 어떤 게 예상될까요?
Well, I think that DRAM and memory is going to be very strong. Tech in general will remain strong. There will be a little bit of a pause, perhaps, as the vaccine is rolled out. Because there was a bit of artificial demand globally for technology products due to the pandemic, people being locked in their homes and with nothing to do. But I think clearly tech is going to be a strong point for Korea next year. We've seen a big improvement in tech exports the past 2 to 3 months. That should continue over the course of 2021. There is a bit of a drag if we get a resolution of the pandemic. People will be working from home less. If people go out to restaurants, they'll be spending less time looking at their cell phones, streaming Netflix. But in general, we think that we're heading into an upcycle for tech. Also, DRAM. There's been very low levels of CapEx and investment the past 2 years. This should help support pricing of DRAM and tech. So we're quite excited about this part of the Korean economy. And that's really the cutting edge, the most important single segment for stock market investors. But autos also look good with a cyclical upturn in the global economy. That should help global auto sales. And we think that Korean automakers can gain market share because of new models moving into higher margin growth areas like SUVs and luxury. And then other cyclical industries that Korea is strong in, like steel and shipbuilding. Those also should do well if we get a resolution of the pandemic and global growth improves. So I would be looking both at the growth, the long-term structural growth sector, which is tech, but also some of these cyclical industries that would benefit from a resolution of the pandemic.
크레딧 스위스의 댄 파인먼 아시아 투자 부문 공동대표 인터뷰를 여기서 마무리하겠습니다. 어떻게 들으셨습니까?
영국의 경제학자 존 메이너드 케인스가 미국의 그 증시 개미 투자자들에 대해서 흥미로운 말을 한 적이 있는데, 내가 만난 사람들 가운데 가장 자기들을 내가 우리를 내 스스로를 어떻게 생각하는지보다도 내 우리를 저 다른 사람들이 어떻게 생각하는지에 대해 더 관심 갖는 사람들이 개미 투자자들이다. 이 말의 의미는 사실은 이 불확실하고 예측할 수 없는 상황에서 귀중한 자산을 주식에 투자를 했기 때문에 내가 가지고 있는 시각 말고 다른 사람들, 특히 외국인 투자자들이 가지고 있는 관심, 생각, 그들의 어떤 인식, 인식이 어떤지 더 많이 궁금할 거다라는 생각에서 이번 인터뷰를 준비를 했습니다. 어떻습니까? 도움이 되셨길 바랍니다.
제가 모두 말씀드렸듯이 외국인 투자자들이 우리나라에서 시가총액으로는 뭐 한 30% 넘게 차지하고 있고 또 거래 비중이 아주 높을 때도 있고, 그런데 그들의 생각이라는 게 사실 우리가 접하는 의견 중에는 아주 소수만 그렇죠. 전달되고 있잖아요.
그렇죠. 언론에, 그러니까 저널리즘의 필터링을 거쳐서 전달되고 있죠. 그래서 오늘 날 것 그대로 들어본 기회,
예,
그런 좋은 기회였다고 알겠습니다. 생각합니다.
앞으로 이런 업무 맡고 계신 분들 자주 좀 섭외해서
적극적으로
좋겠습니다.
예. 예.
자, 글로벌 모니터 오늘 여기서 마무리하겠습니다. 수고해 주신 강남규 기자님도 감사드리고요. 예, 시청해 주신 시청자 여러분 고맙습니다.